The Fragile is jam-packed with memorable moments, just incredible tracks, and The Wretched is one of my favorites, filth and all. The song is dark, and I have some really intense visuals in my head when I listen to the song. Sometimes it's a little more abstract. It's like black and red and brown and this feeling of dread and being trapped at the bottom of something and this like overwhelming sense of shame that's turned into like anger and a sense that I've done this to myself. And the lyrics have a lot to do with this, no doubt. But I think even if this song didn't have any lyrics and it was just called The Wretched, I would still feel like I was being harassed by this song. And yet, it also has moments of haunting beauty, much like most Nine Inch Nails music, at least to me. But yeah, it just has this defeated, hopeless feeling. So that's kind of what I want to explore in this video, is how is the music, along with the lyrics, making us feel this way? I want to start with the piano. I love the piano in this song. I love the piano in all Nine Inch Nails songs. But this is what starts the song off, is this slam on the piano. After the largely piano-based The Frail, which most people would consider an inseparable part one to this song, it brings us into this new world, which is so much less hopeful than The Frail. I mean, even the titles, right? We went from The Frail to The Wretched. This is way, way worse. And the way the piano is used in this song makes it sound almost like evil. Like, it is dark, dark, dark. The piano is a percussive instrument, right? So you get both the tonality of a tonal instrument, you hear pitches very clearly, but you also get the attack at the beginning of each note. I mean, even though this is a digital piano, I can still feel like the hammers of the piano are like hammering my soul. Like, there's no hope here, you know? Like, you will be destroyed by this F. The other reason I think the piano really works here is because it's an instrument that we recognize. Like, there's no doubt that that's a piano. So we don't have to do this thing that we often do with Nine Inch Nails music and like, what is making that sound? Is that a synth? Is that a guitar? Is that a sample? Like, what? You know, what is going on? And I love that experience, but when you're focusing on that, you may not really be listening to the other parts of it, like the melody, you know, or the harmonies it's creating, or even the rhythms that it's creating. So this way, we can just focus on the texture and the pitches. This song is in the key of G. Key of G major, minor? I don't think it's either, and I don't think it makes a lot of sense to analyze it from either perspective. A lot of people would probably describe this as very chromatic sounding. And that's legit. There's a lot of chromaticism in this song, which we're going to go over. Another way to describe it is that it's playing in the Phrygian mode. The flat two, he resolves, he rests his melody there for three times in a row. That's if you rest on the flat two and you don't give people resolution, like, that is pure evil. Remember, this is the tonic. You feel that tension? It's like someone setting 100 pounds on your shoulders and just being like, see ya. We gotta talk about this. There's a tritone in there. See, this is the kind of thing that excites me because I'm sure he wasn't really thinking about this, but the fifth degree, like I said, is very stable. It's D in this case. And he's basically turned something that was once like feeling really good into something really messed up sounding because of its relationship to the flat two, which he keeps emphasizing. So between the flat two and five is a tritone. And that's kind of the sound of this. You hear that? So that tritone right there just makes things kind of smell bad. Now the variation that goes up higher kind of softens the edges a bit because we finally get to a resolution on a stable note. Nice. Now we are on the five and everything feels a little bit better. Doesn't it make you feel better? Without hearing the bass underneath this melody, you would not necessarily know what key this is in. So how do we even know it's in G? Well, it's because there's a bass line, and the bass line is pulsing on G. That's the only thing keeping us grounded. Really any chords or chord progressions to be inferred by this motion with the piano and the bass just on G. It just kind of feels like a pedal point, basically, like a drone that's just kind of holding us down. It's like no matter how much the piano and the vocal like fight against it, we always return to the same place. We can't escape the G. Now, I could be totally wrong, but it kind of sounds almost like the sort of fuzzy percussive snare is just the bass, maybe a sample of that line that they then distorted to all hell. They're very much in sync, playing pretty much the same rhythm. They sound as if they have the same delay on them and everything.
And now you're one of us.
Well, I don't think the drums are like in the forefront of this song. They're really what makes it work because that tempo is so slow and plodding. So this kick has a lot of low end and I think some high end. But I also think that the snare has a lot of low end. So it's got this thud sound to it. So there's just a thudding, a consistent thudding. Everything is very thuddy in the drum section. Basically, this song just punches you slowly for 5 minutes. The main thing is that pulse, that slow, slow tempo, just dragging you through the mud and the, you know, other fluids. But let's get to Trent's vocals, not just how his vocal melodies are working with everything, but also how they're processed and how he's delivering them. When he starts singing, there is this amazing delay on his voice that I feel like is really well placed. And it's also very intentionally heard in all the live performances. It's an integral part of how this vocal is delivered. I don't think it would sound quite the same if it was totally dry.
Just a reflection.
Each delayed signal, like an echo basically, is like a little reminder of what he just said. The space between a couple of these lines is really exciting to me because it makes you have to wait and you have to like, you're like dreading what he's gonna say.
A reminder of all the what about reason to continue. And now you're one of us. The wretched, the wretched, the wretched.
I like how he's singing in kind of this menacing, theatrical way, like as if like every line is kind of coming through like a clenched jaw, like just all this like tension and anger and disappointment. And he's also got some kind of processing in his voice that makes it him sound a little bit muffled and a little bit like obscured. And that gets even more muffled sounding when he sings in the pre-chorus. It becomes a lot more about the delivery and the rhythms than it does about the pitches. You know, is there a note on the wretched? I don't think so. And even it didn't turn out the way you wanted it to. It didn't turn out the way you wanted it, did it? That part also sounds like he's not really singing anymore. He's kind of just seething at you. But overall, the pitch of his speak singing does rise up. There is a build into the chorus. Didn't turn out quite the way that you wanted it, right? So you still feel the effects of pitch, just in a non-musical way. I love the way he changes up that line. It didn't turn out the way you wanted it to. It didn't turn out quite the way that you wanted it. It's like the line didn't even turn out quite the way that you wanted it to. This tension builds and builds until it kind of explodes into just this like mocking anger. Okay, now let's look at some of the things about this melody that I find really interesting. In the verse, he's basically just singing the same five notes, almost like he made up his own pentatonic scale. So we've got the tonic, we've got the 3, the 4, the 5, and the flat 7. This kind of sounds like a Mixolydian scale that got sort of emptied of some of its notes. But you could kind of interpret it in any way you want because it's not really, there's not enough notes here to determine a scale. Like I said, it's kind of a custom scale. Notes in this particular rhythm is definitely a tie-in into The Great Below. Also hear that comeback once in We're In This Together. It has all these associations, right, of feeling like bittersweet, hopeful, tender, and it's being sort of like destroyed by that flat 7. Forget it. In the second verse, he's still sticking to the scale. To me, because he skips over the stable notes completely. He just goes flat 7, 4, and you could hear how tense that is. He's just going, God in double reaches, fucking on through. And it's not until he finally goes to through that he resolves all this tension he's built up. And so it literally does feel like finally something had. Oh, I shouldn't do that. Back at the beginning, there's that major third, then sinking, spinning. Love that. So he's really not gone to that note. That's a B flat. So we've been hearing all of this. Then he finally goes, sinking, spinning. And you can just feel the hope drain away, you know, and the fact that it goes down, it just feels like, okay, everything's fucked. By the way, when he says, fucking on through, it's completely synced up with the drums. It just feels like they are both being percussive together, and it's percussive. Anyway, it's very satisfying. One of the best examples of this little mini scale is his run that goes up to the second chorus. Like funky tritone, but you also can feel the edgy, like, I don't give a fuck flat 7 a lot. And then sort of the sweetness or the mocking tone of that third. especially the 4-3 resolution, which is all over this song. We hear it a lot in Nine Inch Nails music and in music in general. Doesn't it make you feel better? But yeah, a lot of his phrases end that way here, and it's just sort of this like reminder that it did not turn out the way you wanted it to. And I like the way he's done it, because I like this part a lot. He kind of hits... he hits like most of the notes. It just sounds like this kind of warm, like dominant seventh chord. And then, the way he ends it, he finally gives us the satisfaction of ending on the tonic, the G. Because he hasn't done that. Fifth. Third. Fifth. And finally, that triumph, which is taken away so quickly by this artifacting of his voice, this breaking apart of his voice, glitching out. It's so cool. During Trent's run up the scale, a new sound comes in. Beautiful sort of flashing, I don't know if they're synths or if they're guitars, which is a very common confusion for me with Nine Inch Nails music, because he can make them sound like each other. I don't know. It's very cool. But it goes up. This is one of the prettier parts of The Wretched. It's really, really lovely. We have the four resolving to the three, and then dipping all the way down to the five, and then reaching up above for the octave. But still these same three notes. It's just reordered. It just sounds like a beautiful golden blade or something. In the chorus, he does deviate from his five-note scale. He adds a flat six. Now, if you're surprised that there are pitches that he's singing, it's kind of buried. You know, there's a lot of distortion and anger and emotion and just layers being thrown around here that his actual singing can get a little bit covered up. He's starting on the flat seven, going to that flat six, which is very dark and heavy sounding because it's a half step away from the fifth. And so that's kind of got a similar sounding relationship between the flat two and tonic, six, flat six, five, flat two, one. No surprise that those are fifths apart, perfect fifths. So this sounds way less hopeful. Now you know. To land on the fourth and not resolve it is another sort of like dick move. It's like, sounds so unsatisfying. So much so that when I was younger, I think I really wanted him to resolve to the third, and so I would sing it like that. Now you know this is what it feels like. Yeah, that made sense to me. No, this is what it feels like. Now, you know, this is what it feels like. There's actually a vocal harmony as well. At live performances, somebody else is singing the vocal harmony, but in the studio version, it's just another overdub of Trent singing the G with every single note in his melody. And the first interval that creates, the space in between, is a major second, which sounds like this. It's very tense. The distorted guitars provide so much for this song. They provide texture, they provide tension, harmonic tension, interesting melodies. They can sound very I don't know, like almost like sound design, right? Just so many layers. And we know that this is one of the ways that Nine Inch Nails makes use of guitars. They completely drive the chorus with a chromatic riff that's ascending. And there are some other chromatic riffs that are in the guitar parts that are kind of descending and sort of working against each other. So let's look at all those different parts. So let's look at the chromatic ascending line in the chorus. A second to figure out that the first note is actually the flat two, like what we heard in the piano. So there are a couple different ways to sort of look at this. You can look at this chromaticism and just accept it. Just accept that chromaticism is a part of the fragile and that it doesn't really make sense. It's just there to put you on edge. It's just there to disorient you. It's to make things sound twisted and demented and confusing. But another way we could look at it is like, well, it's basically just a decorated minor blues lick. Now I'm gonna take out one of the notes and it'll make a little bit more sense, I think. Sounds a lot more like blues, and that's 1 flat 3 4 flat 5 5 flat 7 1. So this is kind of the skeleton in a way, and then this is like the rotting flesh that it's wearing. That's what's happening in the pre-chorus, is at the same time there's a synth going, which, remember, that's the Great Below theme. So this starts on the fourth, then goes to the 3 and flat 3. So this is very chromatic. There is a bridge. The bridge, it has a lot of different parts to it. There's another guitar part during the bridge that's not chromatic. In fact, it sounds very melodic and harmonious, and it's playing the raised 6, the flat 7, and the tonic. It sounds like this. And then overlaid on top of that is like this wall of sound. It's probably a guitar, but it also has like almost a horn quality. And it's playing the 4th and 3rd degrees, just like we've been hearing all over the song, that particular resolution. These lines resolve very neatly and it's very satisfying. But what I really wanted to point out is that the repetition is uneven. So this part actually repeats 5 times. We get an extra repetition from what we expect. gives way to the plucks, and oh my lordy, do I love the plucks. Don't know what they're plucking. Logic says it's probably a guitar, because I don't think any of them are playing violin. But, you know, there are some strings on this album, so maybe. Oh, remember at the beginning of the video, I was like, it just seems like there are different parts that have their kind of their own scale, their own lane. And to me, the plucking sounds like Dorian. Dorian is like minor, but with a raised sixth. Gorgeous mode. 4 flat 3 1. So we've always had in this song, pretty much. Now we're going that coldness. This is what it would sound like if the sixth were flat, like in a regular minor scale. It's amazing, just change one note by a half step and it completely ruins. Well, little change, big impact. These plucks actually remind me a little bit of the beginning of Reptile, you know, where it's this very soft plucking. Both have a very significant delay on them, which takes something that was very pretty and pure and makes it just a little bit suspenseful and more complicated sounding. But it kind of builds to a guitar solo. It's very noisy, very distorted, and very dissonant, but it does make a lot of sense. It's still got sort of a blues sensibility to it, I think. Like the musical equivalent to did it. So the first note that we hear in the guitar solo is a flat 5. So that's very, very unstable sound. So he starts on the flat 5 and then goes to the flat 7. Sometimes before going back to the flat 5, he goes da-da, little chromatic, like na-na. But it's very dissonant. And that's probably all that the guitarist was trying to communicate in this part is just like, this is not okay, something is wrong. Just like this. This part of the guitar solo sounds like it's kind of mimicking that. I hear what sounds like pulsating screams on beats 1, 2, and 3. And I actually don't know if they're screams. They sound a bit too mechanical to me, almost more like a drill. Trent and Co. are masters of manipulating samples, I've learned, and sound design, but to my ears, it sounds kind of like somebody screaming, being tortured. It's almost like the people from The Becoming are now the wretched. One of my favorite things about this song is the phrasing. So this is kind of zooming out, looking at the structure of the song. Think of phrasing as the start and then the finish of a musical thought. Just like a sentence in a piece of writing. The phrase will create some kind of tension that is then resolved. Often things repeat 4 times or 8 times. In this song, the phrases are 4 measures long. But twice, the phrase is cut short. So the next one starts over before you expect it to. It's a premature ending to the phrase. And that's surprising because why would we expect that to happen? We wouldn't. Happens here at the end of one of the choruses. My favorite is at the very end of the song before the sort of denouement, and he sings, "You can try to stop it, but it keeps on coming. You can try to stop it, but it." His phrase gets cut short, as does his sentence, as does maybe his life. You know, something has kind of overtaken him, and that just goes so perfectly along with what he's saying. You can try to stop it, but it will destroy you.